his film on Musharraf or Insha'Allah Democracy. My name is Zahra Sabri. I'm a PhD student at McGill's Institute of Islamic Studies. And prior to that, I worked as a journalist in Pakistan. I will be in conversation with Dr. Akbar Zaidi, one of Pakistan's most prominent political economists, who has written multiple widely read books and articles on Pakistan's civil-military relations, among other topics. Dr. Zaidi currently teaches at Columbia University and has just now become the executive director of one of Karachi's most prestigious academic institutions, the IBA. It is an honor for us to have him here with us tonight. Thank you very much for coming. Before beginning the conversation, I'd like to thank all our colleagues and partner organizations who helped us to put this together this event. Our thanks to the Institute of Islamic Studies and especially its Graduate Student Council, including the President Shirwan, who's here. Sabina Sheikh from HARF, which is the Journal of South Asian Studies at McGill. Hussein Awan from the World Islamic Studies and Middle East Students Association. Sajneet Kaur Mangat from McGill South Asian Collective. Zofi Chah Hassan and student Tasty Biryani for giving us the chai and samosas, which are there on the table for you all. So please do help yourself. Hope you helped yourself when you came in and please have some more, yeah. I will put some questions to Dr. Zaidi for about half an hour and then open the floor up to questions from the general audience for a further 20 minutes or so. So Dr. Zaidi, to begin, as we know, when the film's trailer came out, there was some criticism in the media which interpreted this film as one which heavily exalted
the former Pakistani president Pervez Musharraf. However, having watched the film, that's clearly a misreading. Though the narrator speaks openly about his relationship with and hero worship of General Musharraf, the film does come across as more of a satire on Musharraf in many parts. However, would you say that the film is still a little soft on Musharraf? Even accepting that the filmmaker is presenting his own subjective point of view, would it not have been appropriate to be a bit more harshly critical of Musharraf's rule and its legacy? What are your reflections on this and other aspects of the film? Please be expansive.
I had no idea what this film was about. I should have Googled it before I came. I was tempted to, but I said, okay, let me just go and play blind and see what happens. So I had absolutely no idea. I knew about this film, I've heard about it. I think we stopped it at the best part in the Aruande song was going on. I think he should let that play. I don't know what Mo's problem is. I think he's very, very confused, but he's at least honest about his confusion. And like so many other Pakistanis, he thinks that the military is the savior for Pakistan, and it's not uncommon for a lot of, I don't know whether he lives abroad, and if he lives abroad, that sort of underlines this case that a lot of Pakistanis who live abroad feel that the solution to Pakistan's problems, even today, is the military. And I said there's a lot of confusion, and of course, when you're entitled to confusion and ask questions. But I think it was very soft on Musharraf. I think it didn't, I think the very bad account of history and a very bad mismatch, you know, the collage here and there. And sometimes you have a voiceover and a sound which does not seem to depict the visuals. So, you know, it's playing with a number of themes, so I'm not sure. There are lots of cuts back and forth. And obviously, he got a lot of frequent flyer miles between Dubai and Islamabad and Karachi, because every few days he was in Dubai and back, not Musharraf this morning. But I think he is very soft on Musharraf, and he does ask questions, but not forcefully. And Musharraf himself reveals that how foolish he himself was, and he recognizes some of his problems. But his arrogance never goes away. I mean, I think he, and if any of you have seen Musharraf earlier on, he comes from this group called the SSG in the military. And from the first day when he became Chief of Army Staff, there was this swagger. And you know, you see that even in the press conferences with Bush. So I think that stays throughout, and even in the end, there's no remorse. And he says, no, I don't regret anything. And he's always saying how well the economy did. So that's problematic. And there's so many other things in this. I mean, there's a theme which comes through over and over again about this Talibanization and the suicide bombers. Actually, it started right under Musharraf in 2007, on the 4th or 5th of July, I think, when the Lal Masjid in the Red Mosque in Islamabad was attacked by the military, destroyed, and according to some reports, maybe 1,000, certainly a few hundred militants, Islamic militants, were killed. And they swore at that time that they would take revenge. And if you look at the suicide bombings in Pakistan, they actually start a few months after that destruction of the Lal Mosque. And you know, there's no mention of that. So it's a very poorly shown historical account. I don't think it's honest. And you see Mo's anxiety and his own confusion about his own self. He's going through some crisis, wanting to vote and sort of save Pakistan. But I'm not sure whether he knows from whom.
I remember remarking to somebody that there are moments, you know, we did hear about Musharraf and his personality from people who worked with him. But, you know, for many of us, we were very young. Many of us present here when Musharraf had come to power. We saw him at the end as well. But so this was actually quite an intimate glance of Musharraf. You know, he got a lot of access to Musharraf, and he got some kind of footage which, you know, wasn't necessarily available in interviews in general, which are in a different way. So I was remarking to a professor of Urdu, and I was telling him that, you know, this movie, it's funny in the sense that it does make Musharraf, without Musharraf knowing, the camera has some satire in it. It makes Musharraf look foolish at times. So someone said, well, you don't have to make Musharraf look foolish, it just comes across. So that's a bit of that in there. But yeah, the reading of history and the connection.
One thing, Mo would have voted for Musharraf had he been allowed to take part in the election. So I mean, after all this, he said that the reason why he didn't vote for Musharraf and he voted for Imran Khan, I don't know which is better, but he voted for Imran Khan. And, you know, only because Musharraf could not stand a contest election. So he would have, in 2013, had the court allowed Musharraf to take part in the elections, Mo would have voted for him. So, you know, in some ways, despite this truth and this foolishness which comes through, which you're mentioning, Mo was not convinced. He said, go back to Musharraf. So, I mean, it's only by default that he didn't end up voting for him.
So if Musharraf had stood up and Mo would have voted, he would have been a kind of a minority, very small minority, don't you think?
I mean, this is a press conference which was shown when Musharraf came and landed at Dubai, and you know, he always does this. It was telecast live, and there were very, very few people. I think it was probably the most disappointing moment in Musharraf's life, that so few people turned up. I mean, he always thought that he was very popular, he would come and speak through, and you know, this is a parliamentary system, as it is in Canada. It's not just the US elections or any presidential elections. So you need 170 seats to win. And you know, I don't think there were 170 supporters of Musharraf. So it's a strange world which Musharraf lived in, created. As chief of the army staff, you can take over power, but that doesn't make you popular. And you know, I think that people did support him. There's no question about it. But to contest an election is very different from taking over power and then and with the might of the military behind you, you're bound to be liked by a lot of people.
Now, to get away from the film now and to use that as a sort of a pad to now start talking about the Musharraf years and the legacy and the recent judgment. You know, in an article that you wrote, as soon as Musharraf took power in 1999, you stated your belief that his government was bound to fail in its stated objective of getting Pakistan onto a solid developmental track, because beneath all the talk, it really basically lacked vision for achieving key goals. And that was very clear to you in 1999. In another article that you wrote in 2001, after 9/11, you said that you believe that Musharraf's government is here to stay for quite a while now, because just like 1979, when the Americans needed Zia for their war in Afghanistan and thus helped shore him up, once again in 2001, the Americans were going to war in Afghanistan and a military dictator was there in Pakistan to help them, and thus a Pakistani dictator would once again have the international support of a major democratic superpower to shore up his rule. However, I'd like to ask you how important you think the war was, do you think, in shoring up Musharraf's rule with American or wider Western support and helping him survive for as long as he did? And how important was his own charisma, or at least people's indifference to who ruled them? Do you think he ended up staying longer than he himself intended?
Of course, there's no question about it. I think you see the parallels with Zia-ul-Haq as well, and they're very similar. Zia-ul-Haq took power in 1977. 1979, the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan, and Pakistan became the frontline state. And similar things, but far more acute, because 9/11 happened, that was an attack on the United States, and that was very different from the Soviets invading Afghanistan. But if you look at the first 2 years of both Zia-ul-Haq and 2-3 years of Zia-ul-Haq and Musharraf, you find that the economy is actually not doing well. It's doing very poorly. You find that, you know, there are Musharraf doesn't have any sense of legitimacy, any sense of control. He has the might of the military behind him, and he comes into power, and the Supreme Court gives him 3 years. So this up to 2002, after which he was supposed to contest elections and do different things. But there's no question about it that 9/11, just like the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, allowed military dictators to stay on in Pakistan. And it was not just, I often say this, it's ironic that, it's not ironic, but the United States has never brought about a coup in Pakistan. I mean, it's not like Pinochet or in Iran in Mossadegh's government in 1953 or in Guatemala and other Latin American countries. But whenever there's something, whenever something has happened in Afghanistan, 1979 or 9/11, a military general has happened to be in Pakistan, just the Americans' good luck. And I fear that if Bajwa takes over now, something will happen in Afghanistan. There you go, we have that pattern. But without American support, and especially after 9/11, Musharraf could not have stayed on in power. And I mean, you could see the way he was with Bush in the press conferences. And we coined a term at that time called Musharraf, where Bush and Musharraf, they became best buddies. And Musharraf was invited to his ranch in Texas and so on and so forth. And he used to say that Bush is my best friend and so on and so forth. So they had that understanding. And there's no, again, you know, this thing that Musharraf was supposedly threatened. He didn't answer that question. He was supposedly threatened that unless you support us, we will bomb you into the medieval ages. And I think it was Armitage or somebody who had made that, which he dodged in that, by saying that his publishers didn't allow him to say that. So, you know, it was something that worked in Musharraf's favor. And that's why, just like it did in Zia-ul-Haq's time. I mean, I don't think the Americans would have liked Zia-ul-Haq to stay on, but just because he served their interests. And the same thing happened, you know, after 9/11. So the parallels are very, very similar.
About that bombing into the Stone Age, has that been questioned? But did it really happen? What do you think about it? I've heard some skepticism about it, so I'm unsure.
I think Condoleezza Rice may have written about it in her book. There are a couple of other people who've written about that period, so it has been documented. Now, I don't know whether Musharraf has admitted to it, but it has been documented by others.
So now talk a little bit about the nature of Musharraf's, you know, of course we had three major military periods of military rule, and each of them have their own features. Talk a little bit about the nature of Musharraf's rule, and also to compare it with dictatorships in many other countries. It may often have felt to the people that this was, you know, as harsh or perhaps less harsh than the democratic setups of the 1990s, but also, you know, you in one place you've written one of the ways that Musharraf attracted support or at least indifference from, let's just say, passive sort of support from civil society, at least, was that the seductive enchantment of a liberal lifestyle masquerading in a general's uniform, talking about enlightened moderation. So that's one of the things that you had said, and also. Could you please talk about a little bit about that, about generally how the military has been able to have a rather easy time coming in each time? Because another place that you've written in another article that the military only filled a large vacuum. It walked in without firing a shot, not once, without firing a shot, you know, not once, but on three occasions. And you say that there is no constituency. The reason that that happened is because there is no constituency for democracy which existed in Pakistan. in those years. Yeah.
So that, I think that's changed a little bit. I think one thing that's very different is that Musharraf also says that when he took over power, unlike Ziaul-Haq and Ayub Khan, he didn't declare martial law. He said, I'll become the chief executive of Pakistan. It's very different. There were no military courts at that time in the early years. So it's very different. So that's the major difference. And I think this post-1979, after the Pakistani state created the Taliban with the help of the CIA, the ISI, the Americans, the Saudis. I mean, there's no mention of Saudis in this, but they played a very important role in how Pakistani society has changed and supplying money to the first period, maybe later as well. Osama bin Laden came from Saudi Arabia. So I think that there is this sense that Musharraf was a liberal. And this term liberal is a very strange term. He's not a political liberal. He likes to drink. He's very fond of the good life. Unfortunately, we didn't see any shots in this movie, but you go to YouTube and you'll find a lot of things, which is fine. I mean, Musharraf is entitled to do whatever he wants in his private life. But the sense of being a liberal was what some of us called a lifestyle liberal.
Also, patron of the arts, that kind of
work. Shocking mizaj. That's the best word. I don't know how to translate that. Maybe you can translate that. He was fond of the good things in life. There's no question. And many things which one can't.
Fond of the pleasures.
Yeah, certainly. He enjoyed numerous pleasures of that sort. And the arts and things like that. And that's true. The arts, and it's a different, slightly different game. There was a concern in Pakistan that rather than amongst what you call civil society, amongst the elite, especially the westernized elite, that okay, he is going to fight against Talibanization. He is going to fight against, he's a liberal. And a lot of Pakistanis didn't care and still don't care about the difference between democracy and dictatorship. They're more concerned about, there should be, women should be allowed to wear sleeveless clothes, there should be coffee shops, there should be fashion shows, there should be film festivals, and that's more important than democratization and democracy. And I think some credit to Mo, he asked earlier on, he asked the general, but don't you think that there should be a process of democratization? And Musharraf says, no, the military is there to bring about democracy. He says that. When he took over, like Ziaul-Haq did. Ziaul-Haq, Ayub Khan, Ziaul-Haq and Musharraf read almost exactly the same script. And in the newspaper you work with, the Herald, they reproduced the three speeches made by the generals when they took over power, and they're very, very similar. But I think that Musharraf was also supported by this liberal intelligentsia, the NGO sector. In his first few years, there were a large number of men and women from the NGOs. I mean, even somebody like Umar Azhar Khan, who was a great Democrat. I mean, he was part of this government, and many others as well. Because they thought, and it's interesting that, if you see that Fawad Chaudhry sitting there, I don't know if any of you know who Fawad Chaudhry is. He's now in Imran Khan's government.
He's in every government.
Imran Khan actually has about, I think, 14 or 15 members from Musharraf's government in it as well, and they all represent. So I mean, there's this recycling of things, and when Musharraf wanted to produce a different type of democracy in Pakistan, the people who ended up with him in the PMLQ were largely the same people who were in parliament before. So in some ways, things didn't change. It was just Musharraf who tried to present a very lifestyle liberal sort of face with these art exhibitions and things like that. And a lot of Pakistanis, especially the elite, did support him. There's no question about that. But they didn't support the idea of democratization. And democracy is a very dirty thing. It doesn't happen. It takes years. And it's not always an outcome which one would support and like. But it takes years for it to mature. So the last point that you raised is there a constituency in Pakistan for democratization? I think it's growing now. And I think it grew a great deal after the 2007-2008 lawyers' movement when Musharraf was forced out. He didn't resign. I mean, to say that I voluntarily resign is actually not true. There was an impeachment process against him and he was forced out. And unfortunately, he got the protocol, as we saw, because he was going out of the president. So there was a democratic movement in Pakistan. The lawyers' movement, the People's Party, Imran Khan's party, and Nawaz Sharif played a very important role.
And I think the constituency has grown. It's been compromised many times, but it's different now from what when it was, you know, in the late 1990s.
Why wasn't it there so much, do you think, in the 50s, 60s, later, the 80s? What, you know, you compared things with India as well, that's an obvious comparison. But, and you said one of the reasons that Nehru's presence mattered a lot. But why do you think that it wasn't so strong earlier?
No, I think the evolution of Pakistan is very different from most countries. You don't find countries being born out of, you know, after colonialism the way Pakistan was. And I think that this, it's also unfair to compare India with other countries, because if you look at it, India is one of the few countries which became democratic soon after independence. But if you look at other post-colonial states, they became dictatorships. They were ruled, one person ruled for many, many decades. So Pakistan was not different. I think democracy didn't start. It started very late. It didn't develop. The social classes, you know, that one hoped, middle classes and others who could play a role. Mr. Jinnah died and lots of other things. And of course, I think the impact of partition, you know, the part which became Pakistan, West Pakistan, I mean, there were many reasons. One part which became West Pakistan was extremely underdeveloped. Except for parts in the Punjab, Karachi, which was not very developed. So the whole process of resettling 7 million people who had migrated from India, 7 million had gone to India, was quite demanding and challenging. The other major reason why democracy did not take place in Pakistan was because if elections were going to be held, who do you think would have won? East Pakistan, the Bengalis, which they did in 1970. So approach to stop the right of the Bengali people to elect their own representatives was a major demand, you know, whether it was said openly or not, by West Pakistan politicians, Punjabis, Urdu speaking, whoever they were, except maybe the small nationalities, the Pashtuns, the Baloch, maybe the Sindhis, who said that the Bengalis should be given rights. So when you have 55% of your population living in East Bengal, and 45% who are the hegemonic and they control what is Pakistan, you're not going to have democracy. And then you saw what happened in 1970 when elections are held. Mr. Bhutto refused to acknowledge the victory of the Awami League. And in fact, in one place he's reported to have said, and those who've done their Pakistan studies in Pakistan, the book by Nigel Kelly, in which there's this quotation where Mr. Bhutto says, you know, I don't believe in arithmetic. Because Mujibur Rahman had won 162 seats and had a complete majority in the Awami League, and Mr. Bhutto had 81 seats. He said, I don't believe in this. We're equal. The history of democracy in Pakistan has been troubled for numerous reasons. I think the ethnic, demographic divide, the role of politicians, and once the military steps in, you know, it derails democracy. Even when, I mean, the Benazir and Nawaz Sharif period between the 1990s, you can't call that democracy. The military had all the power, as they do now as well. So, you know, it's not a free democratic country. I think there'll be moments. But are we moving towards that? But I'd like to think so. We don't know.
You talked about the lawyers' movement. Could you talk a little bit about the way that Musharraf went? In recent years, we've seen in the Middle East, in Sudan, other places, very few places in the world now remain under like a military ruler, which was not the case, you know, some decades ago. So you see people step down in various ways. How do you think? How would you describe, you know, the way that Musharraf's rule ended? Do you think it ended with one of the causes was the kind of socio-political changes which his era helped to nurture in some ways, such as like free media, etc. How much that contributed to it? Do you also think that he stepped down relatively easily compared to the end of military rules in a number of other countries? You know, there was a movement, of course, the lawyers' movement, and there's a student movement to support the lawyers' movement, of which some of us were a part. But you know, from what I remember, it was an intense one, but it was not so very prolonged, and it was not necessarily, the people were jailed, of course, but it was not necessarily against much state brutality. So it seemed that maybe the military itself decided that, you know, he should go. Now it's becoming more of a liability, and you know, it seemed to end. It took a little while because there was a the Zardari government came in, and you wrote another article asking them why Musharraf still remained as a president. And after a while, of course, he did step down. So could you talk a little bit about how the nature of that going from power?
Ayub Khan was also thrown out by the people.
Much stronger movement.
The working class movement, yeah. Student movement, workers, peasants. And Mr. Bhutto, of course, I think the People's Party at that time was in the lead. In 2007, two, three things happened. I think there's another sort of misinformation in the film. Musharraf had Iftikhar Mohammad Chaudhry had not been dismissed. He was asked to step down and he refused. And that's when this lawyers' movement started. So, I mean, there was a growing, there's a different socio-political difference, socio-economic difference. There are no longer student unions. They weren't at that time. There weren't any working class movements. So it was a middle class movement. The lawyers were largely that. And then, this is in 2007, on the 8th of March or 9th of March, Iftikhar Mohammad Chaudhry is asked to step down, he refuses. Then there's this famous incident on the 12th of May in Karachi, where on account of Musharraf and the way his attitude, a large number of Pashtuns were killed in Karachi by the M2M, allegedly by the M2M. And then in July you have the Red Mosque thing. Then Musharraf steps down as chief of the army staff, and then he imposes his emergency on the 3rd of November, the 2nd or 3rd of November. And then Benazir is killed on the 27th of December. This is all in 2007. It's a very significant year. So at each moment, as you can see, that there's growing opposition, there's growing resentment, because Musharraf is still the president, and so you can see him losing the plot and losing power slowly, slowly, slowly. He did admit, not in this film, but he did admit that it was a mistake to ask Iftikhar Mohammad Chaudhry to step down. I think there was an unraveling which had begun throughout. He had overstayed his welcome. Okay, you know, after 3 years you should go, but no general is willing to do that. So he had overstayed his welcome, and there was a growing sense of tiredness. And I agree with you also. I think it's very probable that the military, within the military also, there were individuals who said, okay, you know, I think he should go. That he's giving the military a bad name because of, I think, Benazir's assassination. Whoever was responsible for that, and the Taliban had claimed responsibility, I think it was under Musharraf's watch. So there were all these factors which were going. And I think that's when many of us were far more optimistic about democracy, that finally we're in a position to push out a military general. These were the trends that were taking place.
Do you think if he had been harsher, if in his crackdown, he could have lingered on a bit more? And of course, you know, that's one of the reasons now why his legacy is being debated, that there are a number of people think, of course, he's, you know, they're glad that he's gone, but they don't necessarily think of him as such a very bad guy. Not all people, but there are enough people who think, yeah, you know, it's good he's gone, but he's not such a very bad guy, because, of course, however the army and the state treats the peripheries of Pakistan, such as Balochistan, etc., but in the core, the big urban centers, the crackdown, the brutal crackdown, more guns could have been used, it could have been more serious. That didn't happen at that time.
Yeah, another thing I forgot, there was the killing of Akbar Bukhti also.
Yes.
And at the same time, we often forget that, and I think there was a mention of that in this as well, or maybe not. But yeah, could he have used guns against the people? I think people would have still come out. And because there was a combined opposition against him.
Also, that was not his image to use guns against people. It could have become, but it was not part of the law.
Well, we don't know his intentions may have changed. But I think the main thing was that there was a very strong combined opposition against him. I mean, Nawaz Sharif didn't like Zardari, who didn't like Imran Khan, and Imran Khan doesn't like anybody. And despite the fact, despite this, all three major political parties, except the M2M, wanted Musharraf to go. And I think that was strong enough. And I think also globally, Bush had gone, Obama had come into power, and things were changing globally as well. And as you said, it became unfashionable to be ruled by military generals. This was, of course, before the
Arab Spring.
But it was, and I remember Imran Khan used to say that there are only three countries in the world which have military generals. One was Burma, one was Pakistan, and I think probably Egypt or one other country. So that was changed, the fashion had changed. So eventually he would have gone. He went sooner, perhaps because he felt that, okay, there's no point. But I think he was pushed out. So one needs to give credit to political parties, to the lawyers' movements, to people like you, the students who were involved in getting rid of him. And so that did happen, yes.
Let's talk a little about the court. I will definitely go towards that. Let's talk a little bit. I'm moving towards like the last couple of questions, because everyone's interested to hear about this. The court verdict that came out towards the end of last year, it was a trial which had been lingering on for a while, and Musharraf had not been showing up for the sessions. And the verdict was that a death sentence for treason, for declaring the emergency against Musharraf. It was a very dramatic verdict. A lot of people had a lot of opinions about it. Of course, there have been developments since then, and many things are being questioned, but that verdict itself was very dramatic. It would be great for us to know, because I haven't read in the press or anywhere you speaking too much about that yet, but what your opinion on the verdict, and how strong a deterrent do you think that really would be to a future takeover? Because when I've seen the movie, and when I saw, of course I remember Musharraf taking over, we were in our teens when he did, but now when you looked at those visuals, there's a kind of vintage quality to that entire thing, and it's very difficult to imagine seeing such a time again, but you know, you never know, but could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I think there's a romance about the Musharraf period, and then lots of people like to think of, as Mo was saying, that without actually being very historically correct about a lot of things, but there is an imagination about it, and I think that still may linger with some people. But overall, when the verdict came out, it was unanimous that you know Musharraf should be hanged. The death sentence. He gets the death sentence. That would have been transmitted as a life sentence, but nevertheless, that's what the court did. And I think that was received very favorably, except by the Imran Khan government, which was slightly embarrassed, and they didn't know how to handle it, so they didn't say anything about it. But by other political actors, there was a sense of relief and a sense of justice. I mean, it's interesting, it's ironic that in this film also, when Musharraf gets a reprieve of 15 days, Raza or whoever his handler is says, okay, this is great, the courts in Pakistan are so fantastic, but when this judgment comes out, the courts are not so fantastic. But I think there was a general happiness about this verdict. Does this deter future generals? I think that the process over time has shifted a little bit. I mean, you can't say, I don't think military generals read the constitution and then undertake a coup. If they did, Article 6 says they're not allowed to do that. So obviously they missed that article, and perhaps they read other things. Like Musharraf said, he's taken an oath on the constitution. So of course, if the military does not read the constitution or does not consider it, I mean, Ziaulak said, what is this 14-page piece of rubbish, and as Musharraf also said something similar, piece of paper. So you know, that doesn't necessarily mean that if a coup were to happen again, or if a military general were to think about doing something like this, Musharraf judgment would make them think about it. But a lot of people do think that this has never happened in the history of Pakistan, that not just a president of Pakistan, but a chief of the army staff and president of Pakistan has been given the death sentence. Whatever else happens, the Supreme Court has given its verdict. So at least symbolically it can mean something, but I don't know to what extent symbols are going to matter if some other general becomes adventurous. But I think they've also devised different ways of extending the life of, serving chief of the army staff. When every single political party took about 45 seconds in parliament to say, yes, he needs an extension. So the military doesn't need a coup anymore at the moment.
Thank you. Do you have any strong opinion on the judgment itself, about its wording, and how what kind of judicial sense does it make? Because it was a dramatic judgment, and people can have opinions about it. Do you have any strong opinion about that?
I think that's lawyers could probably answer that better. I think there was one judge who went a bit overboard and was rather dramatic, saying that even if he's dead, if he dies abroad, his body should be brought to Pakistan and it should be lying hanging for 3 days. But as lawyers would tell you, that was not part of the judgment. That was so. I mean, it was a bit dramatic. But soon after, when the judgment was announced, this particular clause was not considered important enough. So, as I said, I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know the legal side of the judgment side. But as somebody who looks at the political consequences, I think there was a general affirmation of a process. And again, back to the faith in the courts, who've given different types of judgments.
Okay. Last question, because we are against it, for me, and then for over to the audience. Since we are at the Institute of Islamic Studies and we have you here, you know, it would be interesting to talk a little bit about democracy in Islam. Mm-hmm. And for a while, in political science at least, it was a sort of popular debate because so many majority Muslim countries in Southeast Asia, in the Middle East, in North Africa, they were not democratic. And so the debate would be, is Islam and democracy incompatible? How does it work? So what do you think about democratization in majority Muslim countries in general, about the trend? We'll talk a little bit about this debate. I know it's a dated debate, but still, you know, it has some, even now, some relevance.
I don't think it has relevance now compared to 30 years ago, 40 years ago. In the context of Pakistan, most Islamic parties support the electoral process, the Jamaat-e-Islami, the Jamaat-e-Islam, political parties which also win some seats. They support the political process. They are very pro-democracy as well, whatever style of democracy we have. So these Islamist fringe parties who get about 10-11% of the vote, they support this process. I think the Muslim Brotherhood also, they were elected through the electoral process. That's the only way they could have come to power. The way they were removed shows that, you know, there's in fact a strong anti-democratic move in Egypt, supported by Saudi Arabia and by the United States. So it's not Islam which restricts these democratic processes. I think it's other factors. I mean, Saudi Arabia will probably never be a democracy, I don't know. And there are these other kingdoms which don't see much reason to be democratic. They're extremely authoritarian. They're supported by the US and other world powers as well. So I don't think I think this idea of seeing that Islam is anti-democracy or democracy and Islam don't go together is actually dated. I mean, Indonesia is a very vibrant democracy, the largest Muslim country in the world. Bangladesh was a very vibrant democracy, but it's become more authoritarian. I mean, Malaysia, Turkey, I mean, and so many other countries. I mean, I think that the reason why democracy has not done very well in most countries post-Arab Spring has geopolitical factors in it as well. There is the issue of oil as well. I think other than Tunisia, most of the other countries haven't performed well. So it's, you can't say, I don't think it's Islam. I think it's authoritarianism, monarchyism, and probably the politics of oil and the geopolitics of it.
Thank you very much. And now over to the audience, please. Any questions? Mm-hmm. Please introduce yourself and ask a question.
I'm Tamar, and I'm doing PhD in mechanical engineering. So my question is, as you also talked about that, now they don't need a coup, but what's your opinion, like how lines are blurred? You don't know what's happening right now in Pakistan, who is controlling things. Like, in the background you know, but on paper, on page, you can't pinpoint now anyone. So how can we get out of it? Is there any chance of, and like, purple it bring? Like, if the situation is very blurry in Pakistan, there is worse kind of like sanctions on media in the background. Previously it was like we knew that Dr. Musharraf is doing that or this man is doing that, but now everything is blurred.
Yeah, I agree with you there. I think this is a failing of political parties and civilians who have, you know, so the military becomes stronger not only because of the might of the military, which of course it's, you know, it's not a level playing field,
But I think it's also allowed in by political parties. And I think this extension, the way the extension was passed in Parliament within a matter of a few minutes, was a very poor reflection of the of those who've been elected to power and or who hope to come to power. So I think the failing lies there. When you keep withdrawing and going into a corner, you've left the room for other political and non-political forces. So I think the lines are blurred, although people understand what's happening. And you know, how long this is going to continue, what the outcome is going to be, we don't know. Is this going to be just a controlled experiment for many more years? Or will there be some sort of adjustment and some response from political actors? At the moment, whether it's Nawaz Sharif's party or Zardari's party, because they've got cases against them, they've all compromised. They're hoping that the military will allow them more space so that they can come into power. But what's the point of coming into power when you really don't have any power? I mean, Imran Khan is a very good example of that. That you know, he is supposedly democratically elected, but I don't think that you know, he has enough influence or power, unlike Nawaz Sharif, who did in 2013. And then we know the consequences of that. When you take on the army, then you know you are marginalized completely. So there is that dynamics has not changed in terms of the power relations, but its form continues to change.
My name is Sadhguru. I'm an undergrad engineering student here. So I totally agree with you how one-sided this documentary was. Like, those of us who were born and raised in Pakistan know that Musharraf supporters, they were all MPM supporters. And in the elections, the APML candidates, Musharraf's candidates, they didn't even get 200,000 votes in a country of 200 million. And that's the thing which frustrates me. Like, here at McGill, like, those of my friends who are from Pakistan, like, were born in Canada or in the United States, they always say, oh, okay, Pakistani people are so ill-educated people, they don't know who to elect, they should vote for Imran Khan, or they should just, how liberal Musharraf was, and they don't know anything about the dynamics, like Mo. Mm-hmm. Like, honestly, they don't know anything what happens in Pakistan. For example, like just 2 years back, Khadim Rizvi was there, the same military, Musharraf's army, Musharraf's institution, they armed the Deobandis, they armed the Talibans, and now they're arming the Brelvis. And in consequence of that, like, common Pakistanis are suffering, more Shias will die, and more common Muslims will die. And I don't know, like, I think that's the dilemma of our country, like, those people who consider themselves to be the literate ones, the educated ones, they actually, like, in countries like here, in universities like here, they support people like Musharraf, and in consequence, like, we are still stuck in half democratic and half dictatorship kind of a government.
I agree with that. I think also, you know, there is this sense that Musharraf did away with terrorism. I think that's what this movie is saying. I think that's completely inaccurate, as I said. And again, you're right that, you know, that's why I feel that the 2018 election was not completely fair. And, you know, like the Tehreek-e-Lapaq and other groups, and Nawaz Sharif being banned, not being allowed to take part in the elections, Maryam Nawaz being arrested a few days before the elections, and things like that. But it was not a fair election. And you're back to that thing. So there is this, I think, romance with Musharraf, that, you know, he was a liberal. Okay, what does that mean? Okay, you know, you had more coffee shops, that's all you can have in Pakistan. But you have more coffee shops, okay, that's a sign of liberalism, more fashion shows. I mean, is that what matters? And this also, it's also important to correct a myth about the economy doing too well. That, you know, the economy started doing, from 1999 to 2002, when Musharraf took over, the economy was not doing well. After 2002 till 2008, for 6 years, the growth rate in Pakistan's economy went up to 6-7%. And the reason for that was a lot of aid was coming into Pakistan because Pakistan was fighting the American war. After 2008, the economy again slowed down because of the global crisis as well. But we see, this also changed. In Nawaz Sharif's 5 years, every single year, the economy did better than the previous year. I mean, until Imran Khan takes over. So, for every single year, it started to grow. So, you know, Musharraf's economic boom was the rise in stock prices, rise in real estate, but nothing substantial. So a lot of people benefited. You know, the corporate sector, multinationals, Shaukat Aziz coming from Citibank and all his buddies. You know, that lifestyle, that good lifestyle, the desire for a good, aspirational good lifestyle of a certain number of people. I think they still look back, as you were saying, to the Musharraf years as nostalgia, as romance, as something, oh, we wish the good old days would come back. Those days are gone. The whole process through which these changes took place have completely changed.
My question is more about the people of Pakistan versus the military establishment creating a role in the politics of Pakistan. Is it really the people of Pakistan that have like selective political amnesia, that they forget some parts of the government and some parts of specific governments, and then pave the way for the either the military takeover, or they rally to take down military dictatorships and for democracies to come? Or is it really the military establishment that creates these peaks and troughs of the political process? It's confusing for me. That's why I'm putting this question out there to people.
I used to think that in 2007-2008, I was very foolish. I thought that the military has now been set aside in Pakistan and we are on an evolutionary path of civilian political democracy. And obviously, I was wrong. I think that we have slid back. The military is a cultural and political entity which is supported by a lot of people. You know, there's no question about it. Somebody or the other has a cousin, a brother, a father, a great uncle, or somebody in the military. So there is that, especially in the Punjab, you know, which is 55% of Pakistan's population. So you have that affinity with the military. Somebody or the other is related in the Punjab and at some level or the other. So that sense of camaraderie, that sense of kinship, the military is not seen as a pariah as it is in Latin America, for example, you know, in Chile, for example, or Brazil or Argentina. The question that you had asked earlier, how this compares, or in other states, because it's very much, I think it's also Pakistan demography. Out of 200 million people, 55% are from the Punjab, and the military is 82% from the Punjab. So it has those great links. It's not like in India where you have it comes from different parts of India. So because of its ethnic dominance, so I think it's also more accepted in the political life of Pakistan. Having said that, I think the military also, as the second part of your question, does play a very significant role in, I think, as somebody asked earlier about, you know, it's this now fifth generation warfare, trolls and the ISPR and things like that. So it's very present. It finances movies, television programs. Recently there's one going on, I forget its name.
Ehd-e-Wafa.
And also it plays into that, and now it's become smarter and more sophisticated through these means. Of course, there's no single newspaper which is allowed, or media house which is allowed to raise questions about the PTM, for example. Or about Balochistan, or about the Pashtun Tahafiz movement. I mean, the Dawn newspaper is still not allowed in cantonments in much of Pakistan. Now, you know, and there's no official policy about that. If you speak to journalists, they say, okay, we're not allowed to do this. Who told you that you can't do this? We know we can't do this. So obviously, it's these forces are very present. They play a very strong role, and I think that they are anti-democratic, without a doubt. And that has curtailed the civilian, political, democratic process in Pakistan.
Is there any room for the constitution to be revisited, moving towards a presidential system? Given that democracy is it's very unstable. If a civilian president would come, whether or not he stays in power for long, but for the time, it would be clear that he has more control over the country.
I think it's just a, an accident of history that those countries which were part of the Commonwealth have parliamentary form of government, and those which they like in the United States and in Latin America have presidential forms of government. I think it's geographical, historical accident. It's very difficult to say which is better, because you can have authoritarian presidents as well. You can have, you know, fascistic presidents as well, and you can have parliaments which are completely, ineffective. I mean, I think the British Parliament itself, in the last 2-3 years, has been that. So I'm not sure whether it's the process of electoral politics and the difference between a presidential and different. But I think there are, as we've been saying, in the context of Pakistan, there are other factors which are outside of the electoral and political sphere, which have a bearing on what happens to politics in Pakistan.
My name is Haseen, and I'm an undergrad student at McGill, and my major is economics. So, like, one question for you is, like, do you feel like one of the reasons for why we've never had a proper democracy in Pakistan is that like, we've never had politicians who are not corrupt, who are honest, and then came with the will of people, not using military shield or anything like that. So, do you feel like that?
I don't think there are many countries where you don't have corrupt politicians, especially in the developing world. I don't know about Canada. I think they're probably the best.
But not perhaps Montreal.
But I have no understanding of Canadian politics. But I think if you look at the Indian legislature, there are 380 members of parliament who've got cases against them. Some accused of murder and other crimes as well, and they've been elected, including perhaps the prime minister who was accused of the 2002 genocide in Gujarat. This idea of corruption and bad politics, it's not just politicians who are corrupt. I'm surprised Mo didn't ask Musharraf how he's living that lifestyle. Musharraf is one of the richest men in Pakistan. He's got property in the best and most lucrative areas in Pakistan, and Dubai and London, as does Al-Zardari, as does Nawaz Sharif, as does do so many other people. So it's not just politicians who are corrupt. This is one often hears that I think people from different. I'm sure a lot of people here who ride motorcycles in Pakistan have had to pay 50 rupees to somebody or the other at some point to make sure that they are not stopped by a police wala. So is that corruption? It is. But we let that go. So this idea of corruption and finding politicians who are not corrupt, it's not going to work. Not in a country like Pakistan, and not in other countries as well. I think there is a you get the sort of people who exist in a country. It's not just politicians who are corrupt.
So, how do you think Musharraf is able to afford all these things and have all these assets? Like, it couldn't all be the sale of the books, could it? Or what else? Appearances, talks at foreign think tanks or whatever. How do you think he has?
Well, he says that his brother supported him. So I don't know if that's true or not. I know that Rahil Sharif, when he retired, he was given 98 acres in Punjab. And that is very lucrative, productive land, which is worth quite millions of rupees, perhaps more than millions of rupees. And now he's serving in at the pleasure of Mohammed bin Salman. In Saudi Arabia, so he's obviously making money. And most generals in Pakistan end up with fairly affluent. But his lifestyle, Musharraf's lifestyle, seems a bit excessive. If you think about it, I don't know what his sources of income have been. Other individuals support him. And just to give you another point, again, it's not just Musharraf. Imran Khan paid taxes in 2017 worth 1 lakh rupees only, and his net worth is about $30 million. So when you have a net worth, his house in Bani Gala is supposed to be, it's supposed to be quite incredible and fantastic, and he says he has no income. So then in Pakistan we've obviously been able to devise ways where we don't have income but we live well. I think Musharraf is doing that.
Yes, so did you have a question?
No.
Good.
Hi, Professor, thanks for coming. McGill, I'm again from the technical department. My question is, if let's suppose you are made Prime Minister of Pakistan, what are the three things which you will do to make life better?
I hope I don't have to. I mean, you know, you can have a wish list. Everybody has a wish list, but wish lists are impractical. I mean, I would like to say that, you know, for example, I mean, these are silly things, but so I'd rather not answer that question. I mean, well, I can have a wish list, but it's very impractical because, you know, you say, okay, but how can you? How does this work? I mean, what would Pakistanis want? They would want more peace, more freedom, anyone, you know, don't even have to be Prime Minister, more, better security in terms of, but you look at the causes, and those causes are so, I mean, Imran Khan said when he came to the Brookings Institute, I think, a few months ago, that the military and the ISI were involved in the creation of Al-Qaeda and Taliban. Now, for a Prime Minister to admit something like that, so on the one hand, when you want, you don't want terrorism in Pakistan, but you know, when the Prime Minister is admitting the cause of that, so you can't say, okay, do away with terrorism, you have to see what the cause is. So, it's very difficult. But I think girls' education, women's education is fundamental to solving many of the social and economic problems. Having better relations with India, and I think all the three elected leaders of Pakistan, Imran Khan, Asif Zardari, and Nawaz Sharif, have very consistently and openly said they want better relations with India. I actually think if India and Pakistan can have better relations, I think that will change the fate of South Asia and the region completely. But unfortunately, Mr. Modi in the last year has been unwilling to hear the message which Imran Khan is giving. As you know, that I'm not a supporter of Imran Khan, but I think this one position that he's been doing, whether it was Kartarpur, whether it's trying to move forward with India, it's from the Indian side that this not over. So that's one, a second, I mean, area, is, rather than a wish list, a certain area which needs to be addressed. I really think that if India and Pakistan can have relations like Canada and the US, or the US and Mexico as neighbors, you know, that can change the fate, and that will do away with terrorism, that will do away with the role of the military in Pakistan, that will do away with, perhaps that will help deal with economic problems which people have, perhaps create more jobs, economic exchange, things like that. So things of that nature.
Imagine a better taxation structure would also be a
part of course. I mean, an interesting statistic, I mean, an economist here and others might know or not know, only 1% of Pakistanis pay income tax. So that, less than 1%. So when people are not willing to pay taxes, and for understandable reasons, they're not willing to pay taxes, then you always go to the IMF, you go to the Saudis, you go to Malaysia, you go to one country or the other, asking them for money. So you're absolutely right. I mean, that's a huge problem, that nobody's willing to pay taxes. They'd rather build a mosque. They'd rather say that we're going to we have a langar, which is providing free food, but they're not going to pay taxes to the government. So if you have such deep root, and this is not just politicians, this is common people who have money, shop owners, they refuse to pay taxes. So, you know, it's easy to blame generals and politicians for everything that's wrong, and there's some truth in that. But this problem goes much further than that.
We'll take a few more.
I have a follow-up question on my previous question. You mentioned that the army has like 80% of people from Punjab, and therefore the camaraderie between army and civilian people. This very resoundingly sounds pre-partition Pakistan, where most of the aristocracy, I would say, was in West Pakistan, but the population was there. So moving forward, do you see something like Central Pakistan and the rest of Pakistan being?
I actually think that Pakistan needs 12 provinces. And I mean, this is what are called divisions. If those who are familiar with Pakistan, those divisions make a lot of sense administratively, and that breaks the power of this, of the power of the Punjab. And I think that has, I mean, for example, you can identify Makran should be one division, the Baloch area, the Balochistan should be one province. The even Ghazpak Bizinjo, who is a great Baloch nationalist, recognized the fact that Quetta, on north of Quetta, is all Pashtun territory. So Pashtuns live there, also in Quetta. Then why is that considered to be part of Balochistan? You should have a southern Pakhtunkhwa, maybe a Hazara division, which already exists as a province, and then now you have the Sparta area. So there are lots of ways of doing that, and in sense you can have two or three different types of divisions. Obviously, the Saraiki belt is a separate cultural, political, economic entity. Central Punjab is different. Northern Punjab is different. So you can see it there. It doesn't even take much, you don't need much graphics to see that. So, I mean, that's one way of addressing this problem. And that's why I say in India, for example, India keeps reinventing provinces, every states. Every few years, they add, Andhra Pradesh was broken up recently, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Uttarakhand. I mean, these are new states which have emerged as as demand as people demand, and as there's a need, administrative need for that. So we are still hung up with this idea of these are colonial state provinces. These are not designed by Pakistani. So in fact, it would be more appropriate in a post-colonial manner to say, okay, these are colonial things. Let's break up Pakistan into 4, 12, 18, whatever the number is, and redesign them. But that's not being done. So, and another thing about this, it's no longer the aristocracy which is going to the military. That's changed a great deal from the time of pre-partition. Now, Pashtuns, a large number of Pashtuns are going in. There was a time when this area near Attak and Jhelum was the main area where people used to go into the military. And this is not just generals, but this is also the subalterns and subedars and havadars and all the lower cadre as well. But now, demographically, because Pakistan has changed, there's a very good book by Shuja Nawaz called Cross Swords, in which he looks at the demography of the Pakistan military, and he shows that increasingly now it's become urban. So it's people not going from landed families anymore. There's people going from cities, even from Karachi, even from Quetta, and other cities who are going to the military, because the demographics has changed, so has the composition of the military and the civil service.
Can we just take a last question and then we'll
just to add to that, I'm from Karachi, so whenever we talk about a separate province, they always blame us for separatists and that things, So I've never understood what's the reluctance in making new provinces. Like you said, it's a colonial thing. We don't, it's not a hadith or Quran. We can change it anytime. But why are we not doing that?
Nobody gives up power easily. It has to be taken. And I mean, even there is this the chief minister of he's from the Saraiki belt, and he was made the chief minister on the understanding that there is going to be a Saraiki province, but it doesn't suit Shah Mahmud Qureshi, for example. It doesn't suit Aleem Khan, for example. It doesn't suit Shahbaz Sharif, for example. So you have to look at, it's okay to talk about these provinces and creating new provinces, but you have to give up power. Why would Nawaz Sharif and his family want to just rule over Takht-e-Lahore? They want the whole of Punjab, and this is the way they'll get it. Why would the Hazara belt, even the name Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, when they finally decided to change it from the north, west, it took them 68 years, forget about provinces and redefining provinces, it took 68 years or 66 years for a province to change its name from the northwest frontier provinces to Pakhtunkhwa, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, so no mention of the Hazaras there, so the Hazara region there. So, there is a reluctance.
But the Khyber was added on the insistence probably of the Hazaras.
They were.
Look to Pakhtun, the problem.
But it doesn't solve the problem. But on the other hand, one could also say that Gilgit-Baltistan has finally been given some semi-recognition. So, and again, the funny thing is that I wrote an article on the 70 years of Pakistan. There was a series of articles in Dawn, and I wrote an article, and I'm not very fond of Mr. Asif Zardari, but I think that he will one day be seen as Pakistan's greatest democrat, because the 2008 to 2013 period was the most difficult, where the transition was made after Benazir Bhutto, and Asif Zardari had no experience running government. But if you look at that government, the People's Party government, they brought the 18th Amendment, they had the National Finance Commission Award, their Gilgit-Baltistan issue was addressed, and a couple of other things also happened at that time. So democracy actually does a lot of good things. We may be very impatient. You know, I think Muhammad Hanif once said, we are very impatient with democracy, we are very patient with dictatorship. I think it was him who said this. And that's true. So when we get Imran Khan, when we get Benazir, when we get Nawaz Sharif, we expect them to undo things that have happened for the last 50 years in a matter of 45 days. So it's not going to happen that way. So I think, and if you look at what Nawaz Sharif did, at least that's what Mo also mentioned, that it's interesting that in the last Nawaz Sharif government, the number of laws that were passed in favor of women, and the Punjab, which is supposed to be so conservative, the number of anti-harassment, anti-sexual harassment, and other women's safety of place and act and things like that, the large number of acts were passed in favor of gender rights and women, recognizing women's agency. So even conservative governments under democracy can offer possible solutions. So I think the debate, we should move on and say, okay, it takes time. I think Imran Khan, whatever he's trying to do, whatever he's failing at, whatever he promises to do, one has to give these processes time. They're not going to happen in a matter of a few months.
Thank you very much, Bulent here. And please join me in thanking Professor.